Holy Spirit, right again. The weather forecaster's wrong again. Only people get paid to be wrong. They said it was going to rain this afternoon, be very rainy afternoon, very cold, rainy, nasty afternoon, but no rain, you know, until 3 o'clock in the afternoon. Well, there's something we need to do if it rains. So we say, okay, we don't need to do it until the afternoon. Well, guess what? It rains in the morning, and then no rain in the afternoon whatsoever. However, it gets better. Little antidote to start this video off. The Holy Spirit said, play golf today. You got to play golf today. I said, no, are you kidding me? I mean, it's very cold. It's going to rain. I don't have rain gear pants. I'm going to get soaked. It's going to be miserable. It's going to be the worst day of my life. This is nuts. He said, no, go, got to go. I said, wow, okay, you're the boss, but I'm telling you, I'm going to hate this. Well, I go, and there's not a drop of rain, not a drop of rain, and I had one of the best times of my life. It was fantastic. Nobody's out. Everybody thought it would rain. Everybody listens to the weather forecasters. No rain. So I had the place to myself. Very relaxing. It played pretty doggone well. I mean, the fitness stuff starting to click in place. And so, quite interesting. It seems like the more technology we get, the more the weather forecasts are mistaken. You look at every hour you look at it, it's different. It's just amazing. I don't know where they're getting their weather forecasts, but people are starting to notice this. You know, 3 days out, 4 days out, it was rain out. No, sunny. They can't even get it the right forecast of the day. What is going on? Anyway, beneficiary of that. Welcome to the video. I'm on fire today. I'm in great shape. I didn't get worn down, didn't overdo it, didn't lose any golf ball. In fact, I gained one. This is quite extraordinary. Played smart, played under control, played focused. I found, discovered something very interesting that pertains to the spiritual path. I found there's three levels to three types of golf shots. You can hit an idiotic shot, an amateur shot, or a pro shot. And I found that I always start off with an idiotic shot. I'd hit it, and then I'd say, wow, that was an idiotic shot. And since there was nobody on the course, I'd say, let me try another one. Let me hit this one a little better. And then I'd hit it better and say, wow, that's a good amateur shot. And then I'd say, okay, now let me do the pro shot. And then I'd hit a great shot. Just like, I say, there's the pro shot. And I found out I'm able to play. I play all three shots, and over and over and over again. 1, 2, 3, idiotic shot, amateur shot, pro shot. I said, "This is very interesting." I said, "Why don't I just hit the pro shot first?" As looking into the mind. Now, the spiritual path, we have to look within our mind and see what is going on in our mind. Really, we have to. We can't have someone do it for us, go to the pharmacy and buy pills. What is going on in our mind? So I'm looking at this, and this is really extraordinary. I say, I mean, the pro shots were really pro caliber. It's right there, just like terrific. I said, that's easy. Well, what am I doing? So what I started to do was I started to praise everything. I said, wow. Great, perfect. That's a really great idiotic shot you hit. Perfect idiotic shot there. Wonderful. Great idiotic shot. And I hit an amateur shot, I say, great amateur shot. If I hit a pro shot, I say, that's a great pro shot. And so I just started praising every single shot I hit. I just praised it. Okay. Out there on the golf where I hit this idiotic shot, and I'd say, all right, that's great. Great shot. Great idiotic shot. Great shot. Great shot. Exactly what I want here. And oddly enough, it was quite extraordinary. I scored better than ever. I mean, it it's really quite extraordinary what happened today. And it's all spiritual, because we're talking about our mind here. You see, our mind is revealed to us all the time, but golf tends to reveal it to us quite obviously. So on the first tee, I did something perfectly idiotic. I took a 3-wood, which I haven't practiced with that club in years. I just stuck it in the bag and said, well, let me hit this. And normally I'd hit a driver. I'd say, nah, you know, it's first hole, starting off. Maybe I won't hit the driver so good. So let me hit the 3-wood, it's easier. What did I do? I just duck hooked it into the driving range through bushes. I said, oh, lost ball. first shot, lost ball. I said, wow, that was idiotic. So stupid. So with this new praise program, I said, wow, that was an awesome idiotic shot. I mean, just, you did the idiotic thing there. Great. You picked the wrong club at the wrong time, and you hit an absolutely terrible shot. Lost ball, out of bounds. That was a great, great idiotic shot, right? I was very successful at that idiotic shot. So I'm driving down the cart path only, because of the precipitation earlier in the week, not today though. And I say, wow, I mean, that ball is far into driving range, and it's mixed up with all the other balls people are hitting. I mean, it's gone. And there's a ball right by the cart path there. And I just say, what's that? It's probably a range ball. Range balls all over the place. They're slicing into the fairway. I look at it. I say, wait, there's a marking on the ball. That's, oh my God, that's my ball. I said, that's impossible. How did that happen? I don't know. It's the hand of God. And that's how it went all day. Even if I hit a bad shot, it was okay. And as Axe says, well, that's not a bad position, actually. And I can work from there. And it, so I began just praising my shots no matter what. I said, great shot. Terrific shot. And I kept up this praise. And wow, how extraordinary that was. I tended to get more and more confident. And I said, I can't hit a bad shot. You know, even the idiotic shots are great idiotic shots. It's the epitome. It's a wonderfully idiotic shot. But then, by praising that, I began to become more aware. I wasn't all rattled. And I began to say, okay, that's how I hit an idiotic shot. Now, how would I hit a really great amateur shot here? Oh, if I do this a little differently? Oh, yeah, okay. And then, oh, that's a good amateur shot. Yeah, then I stake out a good pro shot. Well, I got to take a little more into consideration and get my yards a little bit. And there's a little refinement. So, yeah, okay, I can do that too. Got all three shots in the bag, idiotic, amateur, and pro. To lead off with the idiotic a lot. But I was doing it less, leading off with the idiotic less. But when you praise everything you do, you start to blossom in a certain way. I realize nobody does this, really. Growing up, it's like everyone says, you hit a bad shot. I was like, wow, that's a terrible one. That's really an idiotic shot. Why'd you do that? That's really stupid. And it puts all this pressure on us. I got to be a pro. It puts too much pressure on us. I just wonder, like, if you could help people grow up and just praise everything they do. So, yeah, that was splendidly idiotic. Because, let's face it, the idiotic shot takes just as much talent as the pro shot, really. I mean, how do you screw up so splendidly, right? Because I can do a pro shot. It wasn't difficult. You know, it's okay, I'll do it this way. It works a lot better. So the idiotic shot, we're intentionally screwing up. We're intentionally screwing it up. This is a fact. When people are, they're intentionally playing dumb. So praise it. So that's really you're really good at being dumb. That is really a great dumb shot there. Very great dumb shot. Literally, that's what I was doing. I was even talking out loud because nobody on the golf course. I said, wow, way to go. That was a great dumb shot. Love it. Never heard of such a thing in my life. So, no bad shots. And I'll tell you, the round was under control. It was under control. I did so many smart things out there. Started to get a lot smarter because I could do no wrong. And the pressure, see, to relieve the pressure. The Lazy Man's Guide to Enlightenment, Thaddeus Cole, says, love it the way it is. And that's the only way. And we could say, praise it the way it is. Praise it the way it is. I'm certainly going to consider this and testing it out on the golf course is a great, great test of any sort of spiritual practice. My new swing, worked. It worked pretty well. It worked pretty doggone well. And the fitness is working. And oh, there's all these little things I'm doing to take the pressure up. And it all shows up. And somehow it's a lower score. It's like, oh, yeah, I just parted that hole and played that one beautifully. And it's like, huh. Cleared the tree there, barely, but it cleared it. It just on and on and on, little things. And if you're not doing it right, all the little things add up and the wheels start coming off. That's the beauty of like playing on a very difficult golf course. It shows up your flaws. Absolutely, you can't hide your flaws. On a wide open course, on like a cow pasture, you just, wham, hit the ball, and hit it. It doesn't show anything up. It doesn't show anything, hardly, not much. Some, it was some, but very difficult, of course. It is reflected. Your stupidity, your idiotic shots are reflected. No question about it. So, it's a blessing. It's a blessing. And another thing, I had such low expectations. I thought it was going to be the most miserable day of my life, and it turns out it wasn't. So I said, "Wow, yeah, this was fabulous. I thought it'd be going to be terrible." Now, so we're working into, we're going to get into something, of course, but this is really is something. I think the more people try to get smart, the stupider, the more idiotic they become. They put too much pressure on themselves and they think, wow, I just can't make electromagnetism. I just can't seem to adjust to it properly. What the heck's the matter with me? I'm so stupid. Maybe I'd just be idiotic, it'll work. They get so frustrated. Well, nothing works, of course, with electromagnetism. It's now the Gnostics had it almost right, but they did make a mistake. They said this isn't the true light. This realm is, which is absolutely true. It's not quote unquote the true light. But they then said that the demiurge or something had interfered and corrupted the light. Which is why we have this false light, corrupted light universe. This is their mistake that the Gnostics made. Nothing corrupted the light. All light is 100% pure light. So if you want to get free of the Gnostic error, there you have it right there. What happened was that spirit, which is what we really are, wanted to change reality, and it asked light to change, to reflect the change reality to us, which light being reality means that light would have to be changed. So whatever we ask of reality of that's what we experience. Now we can't actually change light at all, not in the slightest bit. We can't change reality. God didn't give us the capacity to change reality. No such thing as having a capacity to change reality, actually. But light can pretend that reality's changed. So it can show, reflect to us as our what we're experiencing, or perceiving would have to be actually, because otherwise we would know it's not true. It's a pretense. But it can pretend, and then give a means of ex viewing that pretense so that we're not aware it's a pretense, which is called perception. And so light is simply pretending to not be light, to have been changed, to be changed. This is what electromagnetism is. Electromagnetic universe is light pretending to not be true light, but it actually is true light, see. But don't let turn into a mind freak out. That's not necessary. It's the fact is electromagnetic. It's like a dream, and the dreamer is still the same. But the dreamer is dreaming a dream that the dreamer is different, but it's not really different. It's not really different. So electromagnetism is like a dream. It's a pretense. Light's pretending to be different, to be crystallized, to be, have characteristics that it doesn't have, But it's just a fake. It's a mirage. That's why Jesus and the great teachers say it's a mirage. It's an illusion. It's a hallucination. It seems to be, it's like it's a snake instead of a rope. It seems to be real, but it's not. Light is not crystallizing at all, though it seems to be, right? Because we're perceiving it. We're perception is the mechanism which light tells us to look through the eyes of perception, and then of course we're blinded. We're blinded. So this is the mistake the Gnostics made. They said light's corrupted. We must realize light is not corrupted. It is not in the slightest bit corrupted. All light is 100% pure light 24 hours a day. 365 days in a year. In other words, always. It doesn't take a break from being 100% pure light. So there you have freedom from the Gnostic error. Very simple. There's a lot of errors. I was in church today. If you want to hear errors, just go to church. Wow, they just mixed everything as a potpourri. You know, they just said, well, it's Jesus and there's everything else, so let's just mix it all together and let's see what we can come up with. A nice confection here and throw some icing and a cherry on top and let's call it good. They said, we got to fit this Jesus in somewhere. He's a heavyweight, but we got to also please everybody else, so let's do that too. Anyway, I wasn't paying attention to the service because there was this little girl there in front of us. And she apparently is what you would call a special needs child. There's something not quite right with her. But she was the most adorable, endearing child. Just a precious, precious child. It was quite extraordinary. We were just watching her, this child, really. I mean, she was, if that's abnormal, we need more abnormality. Because she put a smile on your face. She's very, very endearing with her expressions and her movements. And she was not inhibited. She'd go over to someone and say hi like this and reach out to them. Excuse me. And she was moving around, looking up like this. And her expressions on her face were so unusual and different, but not bad, not weird. Like, kind of like, oh boy, something's wrong. No, it's, when she'd smile, she was very otherworldly, very otherworldly. There's no question about it, but in a good way, in a really good way. I said, wow. I said, this child could actually be a spiritual genius. Simply doesn't fit in this world hardly at all. And really, she could be. But people would say that she's a special needs. I don't know. But I've never seen anyone like it. I've never seen anyone like this. Very different. Most children are trying to behave well. They're trying to, they're a little shy. But she simply was moving about and unrestricted and not worrying about her behavior. And yet her behavior was okay. Better than okay. It was quite endearing. The way she reached out to people. She kept reaching out to people and looking at them. And she wasn't afraid to come to people and just look at them. She just look at them like this and then smile and then reach out like this, and just, I said, wow, this is, it's possible that some spirits come to this world and they're so spiritual, they don't function the way we expect people to function here at all. They just don't. And then we say, well, they're special needs and got to medicate them and all this kind of stuff. But her attention was good. I mean, it was very intriguing. I don't even remember what the service was about. It was about the same old stuff. That sounds, bits and pieces sound great, but then they wrap it all up in a paper bag, There's no escape velocity there. There is no escape velocity. So as a golfer, you'd say this is, idiotic shots. But they do idiotic very well. It was a great idiotic service. Really was. They do it very well. But we need great amateur shots. We even need great pro shots right now. We need escape velocity right now. There's no escape velocity in what was said at all. None. And it's the truth. It's the truth. I'm a witness to it. You cannot. Right now is a time of extreme. They don't realize the circumstances, the situation, whatever you want to call it, that we're living in right now. The world is going to hell. I mean, Jesus spent an inordinate amount of time and emphasis on talking about how there would come an end of this age and how things would collapse and get so terrible, and then there'd be the worst catastrophe ever. And he said, "You must prepare spiritually. Prepare, 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 prepare." Now, what was Jesus? Jesus was the true light. He said he was. Yeah, he was an appearance of the true light in the false light realm. The fake light, the pretense light, let's call it the pretense, electromagnetic pretense realm. Yeah, he's just saying, hey, the light is still true. This is just pretense. But the light hasn't changed. Light has not been corrupted at all. This is what he's saying. So he was an appearance of the true light. There have been others who have appeared from the true light realm. Okay, there have been quite a few, actually. They say the same thing. They're giving the same witnessing. All right? We don't need to do anything to make the light real, to appease something, to sacrifice, reconcile. Nothing has that. Jesus came to stop the sacrifice. And I guess the Jews had such a terrible habit, not just them, but others back then, of being obsessed with sacrifice. And in fact, the reading today was Jesus saying, look, God is not pleased by your sacrifices and all this kind of stuff. Not at all. Not delighted, not pleased. No, not interested. How to end the sacrifice? And so Jesus, okay, I don't know if they made this up or what. Maybe he never said this at all. But one sacrifice suffices for everyone, and so you can stop all the other sacrifices. So it was a way to break bad habits. It would be a way to break the very bad, hideously bad habits of believing in sacrificial atonement. And saying, okay, I am the sacrificial atonement. Once that's done, you don't have to do it anymore. This would just be a device actually, sort of a tricky device to help free us from terrible habits. But it in itself is not true at all. There's no such thing as a need for any sort of sacrificial atonement. So I'm still not clear about whether Jesus actually said that or they just put that words into his mouth later, etc., etc. But the good way to look at it is we've gotten away from sacrificial atonement, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. Getting away from all that stuff. So he's just from the true light realm. He's of the true light. So are we. So is everyone. We're just pretending we're not. That's all. And trying to delay the recognition that of this pretense. There are those who are heavily into delay. They're experts, and they think that if they just become more expert, that everything will be fine in their lives. It'll be great. They'll be happy. This is called magical belief. This world is basically nothing but magical belief here, and it's just so tiresome, magical belief. They just, no matter what you say, they just respond to it with magical belief. Well, I can double down on this belief, and then that's fine. Yeah. It solves the problem. In other words, they're saying, oh my God, I feel my delay is threatened. If I just increase the delay, problem solved. No more threat. But delay is threatened by truth itself, really. Because we are truth. Light is real. Light never changed at all. So there's this inherent threat to this dream of the dream ending. Of course, it is based on nothing at all. And no matter how much magical belief we engage in, it doesn't change that in the slightest bit. Now, Jesus knows this very well and has taught us this in A Course in Miracles. All thanks to Jesus for his work back 2,000 years ago, biblical times, in A Course in Miracles, Journey Beyond Words, The Other Voice. All thanks to Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, who has been extremely helpful in some very, very difficult areas, helping get past the whole goddess matrix. Very, very helpful with that, which is a terrible, terrible matrix, entrapment matrix. And then Ramana Maharshi, who, great reassurer. One moment here, someone's clicking there. Supremely helpful, who had the grace to come assure me that I'm going to succeed, and he already said, it's already done, I can see what you're going to do. It's very, very welcome, reassurer, and a great example, setting a great example for us. And then Longchenpa, who gave me the experience of a pure spaciousness, helped his presence help me with that, the contact with him, and then helping focus in on what non-duality really is. These are the four teachers that have helped me the most, I would say. Also, appreciation for Muji, who's in the world right now, who, you know, helped me with being good humor and kind and gentle and humorous, and you know, the certain approach that he has is very endearing, and that's been helpful too. I'm not, you know, I'm not trying to be someone who endorses somebody else in the world right now, etc. But I'm just saying, it's credit where credit is due. I did pay a lot of attention to Muji for a while, and he also helped inspire me to do spiritual taping in a certain way. That this is something that can be done. So there's various teachers that have helped out. There are others, but I have to give them, and of course, the ultimate credit to the Holy Spirit. Absolutely, ultimate credit to the Holy Spirit. Otherwise, we wouldn't be here talking with escape velocity. You have to be fired up with escape velocity right now. The dynamics of delay, they can take drastic measures to try to get rid of the threat of the real light, the true light. And this, they can definitely take drastic measures. Don't put it past them. As I've talked about, asteroid, the Holy Spirit is my whole life, said it's going to happen here. Impact, it's going to happen. They will take drastic measures. Truly, the minds that are steeped in magical belief, trying to delay, I'm very well acquainted with such minds. They are not in touch with reality at all, really. I mean, they are simply going deeper and deeper and deeper into darkness, believing that doubling down on delay removes the threat. And they just keep on trying to make delay worse and worse and worse, thinking at some point this feeling of being threatened about someone pulling the rug out from underneath them is going to disappear. It never disappears. So we have to turn around and say, wow, that way of delay, that's never going to work. Never going to work. And we have to get more and more and more familiar with truth. Keep hearing it. You know, it does work. It does. It seeps into us. It sinks into us. But you have to hear it with intensity. There has to be this adamant insistence and intensity that, you know, rocks you back on your heels like, wow. And this is the big help we've gotten from these great teachers, especially Jesus, in A Course in Miracles, and the Journey Beyond Words, and Other Voice. He's so adamant, uncompromisingly adamant. Now, speaking of compromise, the ego deals in simply magical belief, which is that extending delay gets rid of this threat, some kind of existential threat it feels, which is simply the fact that true light is still 100% pure. and this electromagnetic realm is just complete pretense. So it's going to end. Pretense ends. It's not based on. It's not a reality in itself at all. The capacity for pretense to end always is there. You can never get rid of it. So the ego thinks they can get rid of it. Now, when we say, well, you can't get rid of it, the ego feels so threatened. And so it tries to play like a peacemaker, deal maker. It says, oh, okay, let's compromise between the two. But what the ego is really saying is, well, if we can't make delay true and get rid of this threat, then there's no truth at all. Then truth doesn't exist. Truth can't exist then. And this is another attempt to get rid of reality. But by trying to combine opposite truth and lies, what you really get is just a severe confusion. Chaos, conflict, chaos. And the ego says, well, that's great. That means that truth doesn't exist. So that suits the ego's purpose very well. That's what it's really asking in this deals and compromises, is that it wants, it says, why can't, if I can't have it my way, then there's no way. Excuse me. I guess it's one of those cold, damp. It's supposed to rain. They said it was going to start raining. I checked like at 8 o'clock. It's now 10 o'clock. I said, "What is going on? They just cannot get it right. There's not a drop is falling. This is really extraordinary." Don't they have Doppler radar or something? You just look and say, well, gee, it's not raining. Light ascension, absolutely. Be born again right now. First day of your new life. I did a pretty good job with it. I was praising everything. Great idiotic shot. So I don't know if I want to do that shot, I think I got that shot. Yes. And you know, it's like I said, well, I don't want to be a pro. I mean, I don't want to be a pro. I can hit pro shots, but I said, no. I don't want anyone thinking I'm good. You know, forget it. So I hit the idiotic shots on purpose. Actually, this is what I discovered. I do it on purpose. I don't want people thinking, wow, look how good he is. I discovered that. Well, interesting. I helped fix a problem today with someone. They said, wow, you made a fool out of me. Made an absolute fool out of me. Now, they were saying it humorously, but this is how they really feel. But it's not really the case. It's that these people are trying to make a fool out of them, out of God. They're trying to make a fool out of God. That's by acting idiotic, they're trying to insinuate that light is idiotic, that God is idiotic. I'm just being natural, normal. I'm not trying to make a fool out of anybody. They're the ones that are trying to make a fool out of God. This is true. So, but I found that people, my experience, they don't like someone else doing better than they. They are egotists, and I'm just having fun and just hitting shots that just occur to me, and I'm not trying to show anybody up or anything. I'm just having fun. But I experience that people get very angry if they don't win. So I start perfecting the art of screwing up. I missed that putt. I missed on purpose. I started missing on purpose to make other people look better, you know, so they think, oh, well, at least I'm not as bad as he is. This is the problem with the egotist is if you end up, in my own life, I've ended up, you know, sabotaging myself so they can feel better about themselves. Crazy, isn't it? But this world's complete lunatic, a loony bin, no question about it. They're all trying to get rid of this threat. We don't even know what the threat is. By trying to find ways to make delay, you know, extend delay. And so all these strategies, how can I extend delay? And they think they're getting, this is the only way to get rid of this threat. Well, the way to get rid of the threat is to ultimately accept the fact that all light is 100% pure light. That this was only a pretense. And you know, but there's, you know, fear, you know, to evaporate the continuity fear, and then you won't feel threatened anymore, because the pretense, we can let go of the pretense, and then there's no threat of pretense coming to an end, right? It's already come to an end. This is the spiritual path. This is the spiritual recognition. And most in this world simply don't get that at all. They just are not even in the ballpark. It's an insane asylum. Ananda Maima said this is an insane asylum here. She meant literally. It is. And she had great humor about it, but was constantly having to deal with it. I mean, people just kept throwing these strategies at her, right and left and right and left, trying to trip her up. And she'd just laugh and smile and cheerful this can be. People thought she was retarded. It's like a special needs child, really, literally. These days we would have called her a special needs child, no question about it. And people would say, but even back then they said, nothing, she's retarded, must have injured her brain at birth, and nothing that we can do about it. But she's such an endearing child, you know, it's okay. And people just got used to her. And this child in church, it was similar to that. And you could tell that people really liked her. There's no question. Everybody's smiling at her. It's like, wow, what a endearing child this is. And yet she was acting oddly in comparison to what we would say is normal. And this is very interesting because Ananda Maima, it was the same way. She acted quite strangely as far as what people expect to be the norm. And yet it was never bad. It never acted in a bad way. No one ever had a bad word to say about anything. It was just like she might would just, you know, sit there, might look at somebody. Of course, she said that she was watching. You know, she was watching all these various beings coming and going, spiritual beings, and she was actually experiencing a massive, you know, massive play of light and all the intricacies going on. But people thought, you know, she was just like vacant, you know, didn't. No. Very interesting. Child kept looking at the church, look at the eyes kept going up like this. Like she was looking at something up there. I said, how do we know that she's not seeing something up there? And of course, if she tells people she sees stuff, say, oh wow, she's suffering from cognitive disorders and need to get her on some antipsychotic medicine and stuff. But she'll be able to, you know, contain it. I don't think we can ever cure it, but we're looking for a cure. We'll have a, you know, a half marathon and raise some money to look for a cure. But it's just terrible here. The lunatic asylum in this world, to say the very least. So it's worth hearing over and over. I never get tired of hearing the truth and emphasis of it. This is why I keep speaking. I'm hearing it for myself too. Because if we don't do this, we'll start identifying with the loony bin. We want to go on the lighted way, the true light, and understanding, of course, that electromagnetic light is light pretending to not be light, so to speak, to be different than what it is. But it's a pretense. It's not really different than what it is. This has to be emphasized over and over and over. And again, don't struggle with this intellectually. Do not struggle intellectually. That's dumbness. Just hear it and then just say, wow. Very, very, very interesting. Very compelling. So there's not the corrupted light and the pure light, and we don't have to purify the corrupted light. That's Gnosticism, that's dualism. This is a mistake. Nothing has to be purified. Everything is perfect. Light is still completely perfect. We just have to realize there's no necessity to this for light to pretend it's not light. It's a whim that we had. It's not a necessity. We try to blame God and say, well, God did it, not us. No, God didn't do that. We did. And it wasn't that God didn't. We say, well, God told us to do this. No, God did not tell us to do this. We did it on our own to see what would happen. Kind of like a kid say, don't stick your finger in the socket. Kid sticks their finger in the socket and see what happens. Why did the parent tell me not to do that? Oh, my gosh, I burned my thumb off, you know. Terrible. And then they realize, wow, that's why they told me. So God didn't, again, there's no necessity to this at all. And another thing that the problem we have is that we're not aware of the continuity problem. It's an insidious problem. And we take the continuity problem to be God insisting that this is necessary for us. And this is a big mistake. As soon as we own the continuity problem, realize it doesn't come from God. It comes entirely from our insidious plausible inference of electromagnetic realm inferring that light has changed, then we realize that doesn't come from God at all. God's off the hook. Then we can start really working on a relationship with God, with which is the light. The light didn't tell us to do this. The light isn't saying we must keep doing this. That's continuity fear that is telling us we have to keep doing this. We have to keep doubling down on delay. It's not God telling us we have to double down on delay. And so when you're finally able to make this distinction and own the continuity fear, then your spiritual path is going to blossom. There's no question about it. You won't be the same. You'll be able to go forward on the spiritual path. You'll be able to go forward with it, bit by bit by bit, but definitely go forward with it. You don't have the same old fears that were entrapped with before. So that this is the pivotal issue, is recognizing continuity fear, the insidiousness of it. Those who are starting to get that and recognizing it, it will come more and more clear to you. More and more clear, like, wow, this isn't God binding me to this or insisting I do this. There's not some dynamic of existence, of reality that is compelling me to do this. None of that is true. It's my own continuity fear, lack of familiarity, feeling like, oh, I don't want light to stop pretending to be changed because I don't know if I'll be able to relate to the light. You know, I don't know if, can I know the light? Will light still know itself? Oh, I'm afraid. Stay the same. That's our own fear. That's not some dynamic of reality compelling us to keep hold of this at all. So the more that we see this, the easier it becomes. And we stop blaming God for our troubles. We stop blaming God for our troubles. And Jesus has helped out so much with this, saying, you know, God has not done any of this. We've done it to ourselves. He's not insisting we keep doing it to ourselves, not at all. Light is not insisting, no, that I gotta keep pretending. No, it is not. We are insisting that light keep pretending. Of course, we are the light, but we are the aspect of will that says, I want to experience this, I want to experience that. Light is the experiencing. It's we can't really quite explain it, how reality actually is. You have to know it. You cannot really explain it. You can only know it. Reality cannot really be explained. It can only be known. But we can plausibly infer, have experience, you know, plausibly inferring that reality is still real. That's as close as we can get perceptually. So I didn't lose any golf balls. Isn't that something? This is very, very interesting. because the golf ball doesn't go quite as far as other golf balls, actually, because it needs to be compressed. My swing speed is not quite compressing the ball. And so it's not like a great distance ball necessarily. So you think, oh, I'm not really getting anywhere. But the end result is that your overall game is better with this ball, and I score better, and everything seems to work out better. It's quite extraordinary. And this is the Titleist Pro E1X, and this is what they're known for, is they say this will help your overall game, and you know, they are right about that. It does help your overall game. Quite amazing. I can't quite explain it, but it is true. So my mistake has been to try to get more distance driving and trying to go a different ball. Like for instance, like it's cold, you go to a low compression ball, it'll fly farther. But when I keep switching from ball to ball to ball, I never get used to the characteristics of any one ball in particular. And I feel that that's a hindrance. So I said, well, okay, it's not going flying that far because it's so cold, but that's okay. Let me just stick with it. And get used to it. So there's a great analogy for the spiritual path. Full stop on the wow. It may not seem that we're going so fast, like as fast as some other, you know, approaches that seem to, you know, be fast food. We can do it right now. Who's asking that question? Let's make a breakthrough right now. But overall, the net result is that we end up being in better position in the long run. Absolutely. And so this golf ball, my scoring was way better than it's been a long time, and I didn't lose the ball at all. It just seemed to behave itself very nicely. And I said, you know what? That's a winner. So it's like that, full stop in the wow. The wow, practicing this is intentionally hitting the brakes when we realize the backlash is coming and co-opt the backlash and calm ourselves down before it hits, so that we're already in a mindset that says, I just got to ride this out. Like a storm at sea, we say, I know a storm's coming. Take down the sails, you know, throw down the anchor and head for the harbor. Let's head for the harbor, throw down the anchor, and then weather the storm. When we make great breakthroughs, there's a storm that comes back at us, a storm of uncertainty about how's my life going to be now. This has irrevocably changed my life. I don't know how it's going to be. There's a storm of uncertainty is going to hit. So we preemptively go to harbor, get the ship into harbor, and then ride the storm out there. And so the effects are a lot less severe when we're in harbor than if we're still out in open sea. It was odd. I hit the ball. I didn't seem to go very far. I said, what? How's that possible? But still I ended up... It's better on the shorter shots. It shows up a lot. And it works. Overall, it works. And so this path we're doing here is like, overall, it works. And... of course, we're going for escape velocity, because I said again and again that the attempt to extend delay can end up taking drastic action at times. Drastic action. And Jesus is very aware of this. And he says that at some point it will take very drastic action. And it seems to me we're very, very close to that point right now in the world, that delay is going to take some drastic action. So we want escape velocity. We can ask ourselves, should I hit an idiot shot, an amateur shot, or a pro shot? Yeah, I can hit all three of you, you know, just, well, which, what I feel like? Well, let me think about it. And maybe we can work towards hitting, great amateur shots for a goal, perhaps. Great amateur shots. That keeps us in the game, keeps us going well, right? It takes a little bit of thought. Here's a great example. 17th hole. In the heavy rough, but the ball's sitting okay, but it's wet, heavy, kind of damp, you might say. It didn't rain, but previous rain had left the rough pretty thick, and underneath it was wet. And I figured everything out. Okay, good angle, here's the yardage, right club, and everything was great. And I swung and went deep into the rough and took a big divot, and the ball doesn't go very far. Ends up in a sand trap, and I say, wow. I said, that was a great idiotic shot. Really great idiotic shot. Absolutely it was. And I said, okay, so how would I hit it like a really great amateur shot here? And then I said, oh yeah. Because I remembered that I'd figured something out earlier. And it says, when the ball is in the heavy rough, don't try to dig it out. Hit it thin. Hit it thin. On the seventh hole, I had the same problem. And I said, well, just hit it thin. Don't gouge into the rough, because that's the ball's not going to go anywhere hardly. But the thing is, the pros are so powerful, their swing speed's so powerful, and the angles, they come down a very steep angle, that they're able to do that. But for a great amateur shot, it's better to hit it thin. And so then I tried the shot again, hitting it thin. In other words, don't dig down into the rough and just skim the top of it and hit it thin, and boom, great shot, great amateur shot, right on the middle of the green. Now, a great pro shot would have been to get the yardage just right and hit it just hard enough to get it all the way up to the pin. That would have been a great pro shot. But I was saying a great amateur shot's good enough. I just want to do that. So, we're like in the rough now. We're in this tough situation. We don't want to dig down too deeply into it. The ball's not going to go anywhere. Hit it thin. So we just do this shorthand. We don't try to go too deeply into the questions of the ego, which is, you know, that's a trap. And a good amateur shot, a great amateur shot is good enough for us. Pretty much so. Well, so we may seem like amateurs, but we're hitting great amateur shots here, actually. Great amateur insights. And once we become really good at hitting great amateur, having great amateur insights, maybe we'll start hitting some great pro insights. Sometimes we hit some great pro insights here, no question about it. Now, I had a dream last night that was quite extraordinary. And the gist of it was, I'll hit it thin here, right? That'll get it out of the rough. Is I experienced going through different lifetimes in a certain way. And I saw how I keep getting led into another life, and it's the Shakti, it's the vivacious feminine energy, we call it the Shakti, who keeps saying, look over here, over here. Wow, this is like really, it's really wonderful. Isn't this beautiful? I'm excited. I'm vivacious. Is it? How about let's go look over here? You know, it's that. Oh, wonder what this is like. You know, like the mother to a child. That she can be so, you know, like dramatic actress type of thing of like. Oh my gosh, what's over there? And the child goes, what, Mom? What are you looking at? She goes, did you just see that little, you know, do you see, I saw a little bunny rabbit there. You want to go, oh, we want to go over and look. It's that type of energy that keeps sucking us along, keeps pulling us along, keeps enticing us along. This is what I discovered in this dream. It was such an extraordinary dream. And it, to make a long story short, it was there was this, we were in an airplane, and there's this woman pilot of the airplane, this big 747, and she took off, and she was flying way too low, and she was going down the freeway with the airplane. I said, you're going to smash into these cars, what are you doing? It just, and barely skimmed the top of them. It was just like, wow, what is going on here? Who does this, do they know how to fly this plane? I don't think so. And so then they landed the plane somewhere, like in like Las Vegas or something, some seedy city, maybe Memphis. And they dropped me off and says, okay, you're now go out. And so I was sort of like enticed into the center of the city. And there was a man there that I was just observing, sort of like I was observing everything in this dream. And what was it? We got some credits. They were selling credits at the airport and said, oh, this looks like a good deal. And he got a bunch of credits to, you know, like coupons, but some sort of credit, like a good deal that you can go into a store and pay with this and save a lot of money or something. So he had these credits on him. And we're walking downtown and I looked around. I said, I had this awareness like, I think this is a troublesome place. But he's still walking. And so I was like sort of beside him, like a sort of almost like a formless being, just observing all this. And I said, I think this is trouble. I said, there's trouble here. You better look out. And then these street thugs came up and they pinned him up against a bus, like a Greyhound bus or something, some bus, downtown transit bus or something. And they robbed him, and they were threatening him and beating him up. They mugged him. You know, I was saying, wow, you see, that this is gangster land. And then I realized that this is the nature of the world right now. And whereas in this dream I'd seen like these battles in Europe between the Germans, like it was like in Belgium or the Netherlands or something, and they kept trying to flood the countryside, and these mechanical vehicles trying to overcome one another and everything. And this was basically, I guess, World War One, we were in this countryside looking up and. Suddenly we see all these birds, these blackbirds. So many, 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 many vast amounts of blackbirds. Say, oh my gosh. And then they flew over me and suddenly they started murmuring. You know how the birds, you know, these certain birds, the I don't know what they're starlings or whatever they are, they all fly in synchronicity in these incredible patterns in the sky, these massive groups of them. Well, this is what I was experiencing. They came real close to me, and I heard the fluttering of the sound of all their wings. They swooshed by me. But we're talking hundreds of thousands of birds. The whole sky was this way up, all these diving and swirling birds. I mean, this is an extraordinary dream to see the birds all in synchronicity moving. You know, I might have symbolized World War II and all the airplanes and dogfights and the various things. It was symbolic of these epics, these eras, and always there's this muse who entices our curiosity into the next trouble and the next trouble. It's the muse who entices our curiosity. in Eastern, they call it the Shakti. And they say this: you need to overcome the Shakti. It keeps tricking you. It's the Maya. It's this delusion. And it keeps appearing in forms that are attractive to you. And you think, oh, what what's over there? Like a little child, the mother's acting like there's something really interesting here. And the child's curiosity is piqued. So I'm so curious, I got to see what it is. Well, then it turns out that it's a trick. You know, wow, it's this gangster land we're in. This is how it works. It's a very vicious thing. And our curiosity is what keeps getting us in trouble. And we keep piquing our curiosity through the projection of this muse-like dynamic that seems so vivacious and curious. Like they say, oh, I see something so interesting, you know, makeup and big eyes and heart aflutter and oh my gosh, this is so wow, you gotta see. And oh, I wonder what she's seeing, you know, I gotta go, oh, help, oh my gosh, you know, damsel in distress. There's the muse is always playing this role to pique our curiosity, which then pulls us into another life, another life, another life, kind of thing like that. So this guy's getting mugged. Maybe it represented me, a middle-aged white man, basically. He's getting mugged. I said, this is horrible. I said, this is gangster land. I said, we got to get out of here. What do we do? That's when I woke up. And I'm saying, you know, we need to shift into the light realm. You can't fix gangster land, okay? It's beyond fixing right now, believe me. We've tried fixing it throughout history. You get all these rulers, these dictators who say, off with everybody's head, who, you know, all gangsters, you know, let's off with all their heads, let's just purge everything. But it comes back and comes back again and again and again. We keep thinking we get rid of it, and it's like we're not worse now, worse than ever. We're not talking about just inner city gangster land in the United States, where this culture is spread all over the world. But it's every country, right? I mean, the gangsters are in every country now. You know, we got gangsters in the Middle East, spreading all over the world. It's gangster culture. The movies reflect the culture, the entertainment, everything reflects this gangster-like attitude. And everything's going entertainment, more and more violent, more and more violent. Like Rome, the Colosseum, the gangster, you know, hey, let's have these slaves fight to the death. I mean, that's very gangsterish, isn't it? Very much so. So we can't get rid of it. It's inherent. We all feel so threatened here that we're so kind of the rug pulled out from underneath us. People become very paranoid and very angry and frustrated and attacking, etc. So I said, we have to just simply see everything as lighted. Just change from magnetic light to true light, at least the plausible inference of it, but still perception. Well, fixing the problems of magnetic light, it's unreal. We don't make unreal problems real and then fix them. No, that's not the way. So those who want to keep delaying, let them worry about the problems of delay as far as trying to figure it out. There's nothing you can do about it at all. So this has to dawn. I'm still trying to get this to dawn on me. It's the step of just simply choose the light. Choose the plausible inference of true light. That's the only remedy there is, actually. It is the only remedy there is. If we don't do that, we'll stay in gangster land. We'll stay vulnerable to it. We'll stay within that dynamic. We'll stay, our curiosity will continue to be pulled along. Our curiosity will continue to be pulled along. The muse will keep playing us for the sucker, for suckers. So seeing this mugging and this gangster, you know, I said, wow, this is terrible. I got to do something about this. You know, expecting the man in the dream to do something is ridiculous. That's just a stick figure. It's my dream. They can't do anything about it. This is what I'm saying. Electromagnetism can't do anything about itself because it's not real. It can't fix its problem because it's not a real problem. It's a pretense. So asking electromagnetism for us to come up with the solution is ridiculous. There is no solution like that. The only solution is recognizing it's a pretense, and we don't need it, and we don't want it anymore, and we're not curious about delay. That's the only resolution to all this there is. That's it. So I said that we need to do that. Just shift the scene, flip the script entirely. That's the only remedy, and then showcase that remedy. It's the only remedy for everybody, for anyone. And we can do it. For instance, the 12th hole today, for example, hit what I thought was a really good drive. It went nowhere. I said, wow. That's wild. Then I hit a really great second shot, but it came up short too. But it's on this like wet, just muddy ground. There's hardly any grass at all. It's sort of like, it's like you can't hit it off of that. I try to hit it, the club sort of skids and sticks in the mud. So my third shot, I just kind of flubbed it forward. Really, really, you know, great idiotic shot for sure. And I said, you know, it's just very, very difficult to hit off of this. I said, well, let me see if I can hit a pro shot here. How would a pro do it? He said, and then I just said, well, a pro would do it like this. And then there's like about 20 more yards, very difficult shot. And I said, okay, this is how a pro will do it, like this. Chipped it, boom, 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 right in the hole. I said, easy par. Toughest hole in the course, parred it. So, you know what, we can chip in. Absolutely, it doesn't seem like, I thought like, oh boy. But I said, well, let's just play this like a pro would play it here. So we need to play the situation, spirit situation, like a pro, like a master, like a guru, like a pro. We can do it. We can do it. We don't have to keep hitting great idiotic shots or great amateur shots. Sometimes we can hit a great pro shot. That's what the pros do. They just chip it in. They say, they get in trouble. They hit in the woods. They hit out. The other shot comes up in the short or in a bunker. And they say, oh, okay, well, I'm done with this. So let me just chip it in here. And they'll go in the next one. So what do? They chip it in. And they say, okay, I'm done with this hole. Well, I'll go to the next one. They do that a lot, actually. That's a pro move right there. When you kind of have a real tough time with a tough hole and you're just struggling, and you just chip it in. Sort of like whatever, 30 yards, and that's it. We can do that spiritually. Just start seeing the light. That's all. That's a pro move. That's a pro move. The amateur... great amateur move is to keep the practicing and insights that we're getting, right? That's a great, and the great idiotic move is to want to do it, but not quite do it, and you know, don't even practice. Just keep thinking about it, thinking, hoping and moping, hoping and moping, moping and hoping, moping and hoping. That's great idiotic practice there, moping and hoping. And then you do the amateur, great amateur practices. You know, we do the stuff we're doing, the full stop and the wow, neither, nor, and all this. Yes, I can, I will, I already have. And then the great pro shot is just to start seeing the light. Just start seeing the light. That's the great pro. Pro insight, just see the light. Sometimes we just have to see the light, and it's time right now. We're in a tough hole here. We're playing a real tough hole, and if we don't just start seeing the light, we're gonna really butcher this hole up, and you know, we're going to go down the drain with everybody else who's magically believing that they can get rid of this felt existential threat, which is just the fact that light is just pretending this realm, and it's not the way light really is. If by doubling down on delay, they keep, this is all they're doing, and they're so clever at it. They think, this time it'll work. And that's why you see these people, their personalities, they do the same thing over their whole lives, over and over, the same trick, over and over. They just keep thinking, maybe it'll work this time. I think this time it's gonna work. I just no insight, you know, ignorance, sheer ignorance. This is a typical in this world. So I know I'll get that ball out there when it heats up, summertime, and you know, the right conditions. I'll get it out there. Meanwhile, accept the shorter shots, good amateur shots, and keep working with what we've got. I'm not going to worry and change the ball, do something different. No, stay with it. Stay with it. Stay with it. This is what works here. I really believe that. The awareness of the dream. I said, I see the situation that we're in. I said, hey, we got to get out of this situation. What do we do, Holy Spirit? And the Holy Spirit says, be born again. Be born again. Being born again so you can see the light. Right now we have a life we can't see the light. Be born again so we can see the light. That's a pro shot. Great pro shot to be born again. That's a really great pro shot. That's how the pros do it. We wonder, what's the secret of the pros? Well, that's one of them. I'm discovering some, like the swing plane, doing it right, you can favor the right side or the left side of the fairway. Absolutely. If you just alter your swing plane a little bit, that's what Tiger Woods did. He always rehearses his shots before he does it. He's trying to get the right swing plane and right angle of approach. Is trying to get the muscles, you know, into how, what does he want to do. Best player ever when you know, before he got too many injuries caught up to him, no question about it. So he would say, this is the shot I need to hit, and so, you know, what's the exact plane and the angle, you know, what do I want to do with that. And he'd make these adjustments, just small adjustments, but he knew exactly what he was doing. Want to favor the left side, flatten the swing plane a little bit. Want to favor the right, you know, straighten up the swing plane, make it more vertical. But keep everything else right. But he was the genius at improvising, hitting so many different types of shots so incredibly well, because he would do what he needed to do, and he'd sort of practice it beforehand and get this feel for it, and then he'd do it. We can all actually do that. He just decided this is what he's going to do. He's going to be this great pro. And being really, really focused on that, and that was what he wanted more than anything. That was so that's what he did. Now, I also realized that, like, Jack Nicklaus's secret was that he had the tremendously strong thighs, and the way he was built enabled him to swing the way he swang. But most of us cannot do that. You cannot do is play like Jack Nicklaus did. So it was kind of misleading. He was so strong in certain ways, the way he was built. His core, and especially his thighs, I believe that he was able to generate power from his legs, tremendous power, which so enabled him to stay balanced the way he did, and still with an upright swing plane, and yet still stay down and balance through it. But if we try to swing that way, it doesn't work very well. So he was able to hit it out there really far. We just don't have that strength in the thighs, especially. You start recognizing stuff like that. You say, oh, okay, I see. You know, that's interesting, isn't it? And we relate this back to the spiritual path in that you know, there's some that they have different strengths and they're able to utilize those strengths. But most of us, we have to be careful that we don't try and match that. There's some that, as far as we have to do the sure way and the safe way. We cannot all be these there's certain teachers that are so extraordinary, like a Ramana Maharshi, just okay, I'm gonna be enlightened right now, boom. We cannot try to match, don't try to match that in that way. Keep on with what we're doing here, full stop in the wow. All the effort is necessary for us, Ramana Maharshi said. Nobody succeeds without great effort. Well, of course, he didn't. He succeeded without great effort, but he probably succeeded in, you know, as a result of previous lifetimes. So they often say, well, leave me out of this advice I'm giving you. Don't try to copy me and say, oh, I can do that just like that. No. He said, no, that doesn't work that way. The great teachers are the result of having already done it, or in the case of Anandamayi Maha, having never gone into the false light, never believed in the false light realm, never was curious about the false light realm at all. So I had no karma, had never done anything to get free of delusion, had never been deluded at all. So for her, it was kind of like, huh, what's this place like? But she wasn't overly curious. She just realized, okay, I'm not curious about it, but I'm going to see what I can do to help out here. So we cannot, we're not like that. We have to work at it. We have to keep doing the practice, keep the discipline, keep the familiarity going. Keep paying attention to the dreams. They're telling us something. Very important dreams, if we really understand what they're telling us. I also became aware today that there's a part of us that is simply just feels. It's not aware of the world the way we're aware of it at all. All it's aware of is feeling. That's its life. It's not whether we are live or die or do this or that. It doesn't matter to this part of ourselves in the slightest bit. It's only experiencing this feeling of whatever is going on. That what's the feeling of it? It doesn't view our life the way we view it at all. It's not even aware that there is a body moving around in a world, actually. It's only aware of what is the feeling taking place in any given moment. Really. And I said, whoa, because that's like dreamy. It's just like you go to sleep and you want to have a certain dream. That doesn't happen. It seems like the dreams just are like a separate reality to your normal waking life. They don't seem to have any correlation at all, hardly, right? I mean, it's just, you never know what you're going to dream about. It seems like the dreaming, whatever's dreaming, is unaware of your physical life. And this is what I felt my whole life, that there's part of me that just has no idea that I'm walking around this world trying to survive. Doesn't even pay any attention to that. It's unaware of that. Whether you eat food or don't eat food or survive or in pain or anything, to it's just all it is just feeling, and not the kind of emotions we have. It's different. It's just pure feeling of. And maybe this is our true self, actually. It probably is. And there's everything is just feeling to it. And so it doesn't matter if we live or die or whatever happens, this or that, there's always an experiencing, always a feeling, very rich feeling of their presence somehow. It makes it frustrating because you say, hey, I'm suffering, help, you know, but it doesn't seem to relate to that at all. Maybe these special needs children are like that. They're just in this pure feeling type of mode, where they don't feel they need to do anything in particular. Doesn't whether they'll do this or that. It's still a rich experiencing and feeling. It's like this aspect is not aware of separate people, individual people doing things necessarily. And that's always there. There's a couple of times I've experienced that directly, and I said, "Wow, there's a part aspect of ourselves that's always experiencing this rich, rich, rich feeling of everything, even though I'm depressed, I'm exhausted, I am numb, I don't feel anything. It's still experiencing unalloyed, pure feeling all the time." I said, "Well, I'd sure like to feel have some of that." But I don't think it's aware of us, really. The superficiality, superficial self, the fake self, electromagnetic self, fake, pretense. Feeling is not pretense. Jesus says that's reality. It's just this pure feeling, and so it cannot change what it is. It's this pretense is the trouble that we want to say. Well, how do we keep this human person suffering going? This hero of the dream. How do we keep that going? And the importance of it. And this feeling aspect of us that doesn't even aware of that's happening even. And from its standpoint, the only feeling is happening. But not the feeling of the body. It's a different kind of feeling. It's a spiritual feeling. Just, you know what? I got some pecan pie today. I think I'm gonna go in and get some of that pecan pie. It's Christmas season. I said, you know what? Okay, pecan pie. One serving, 480 calories, 230 fat, cholesterol 230, sugar 38 grams. Oh my gosh. Oh, so, what I had breakfast, had a good br two eggs and a piece of whole wheat toast for breakfast. Then for golf, I took a mango protein drink, 62 grams of protein in that drink, and a banana and blended it together. I forgot one item, Greek yogurt. Next time I'll throw Greek yogurt in. And this is supposed to be very helpful to keep you going during exercise and afterwards to help the muscles recover. So I did that great. I just forgot the Greek yogurt. Then when I got home for dinner, you're gonna love this. I said, all right, time to t had this big package of kale, couldn't fit it in their fridge. I went shopping and I couldn't say, wow, this is no room for it. I said, okay, I gotta start juicing then. So I got the big glass, NutriBullet glass, and filled it up, jammed it up with kale. With this wasn't baby kale. This is, you know, 100 pence kale. I mean, this stuff has the big stems on it. And then I had this half a bottle of pure pomegranate juice. So I poured the pomegranate juice in for the liquid and then blended it up. All this kale, so I got kale pomegranate juice. It's like all this green froth on top of it, like about 4 inches of green froth. I said, wow. Underneath is all this very strange looking brew. And I downed the whole thing. There are a few stems, you know, kale stems, and didn't blend for some reason. I don't know why not. But anyway, just spit those out and drank the whole thing down. So that is, I had, so but I said, wow, I'm being so I'm being so health nuttish that I can have some macaroni salad too. So but then, wow, I cheated on the macaroni salad, so I said, I have some broccoli. So I had broccoli too. And that was my dinner. Broccoli, kale, and pomegranate drink. About 16 ounces of it or so to drink, and then some macaroni salad. So now I'm thinking, man, I was that kale drink, maybe that earned me some pecan pie. I hope so. But just a little bit. Try a little bit and then maybe drink some more kale. I'll juice up some more kale tomorrow. That's hardcore when you're going kale and pomegranate juice. I mean, then actually, it tasted pretty good. I recommend kale and pomegranate juice, actually. I mean, as far as masking the taste, that pure pomegranate juice did a good job. Absolutely, it did. Probably some tart cherry juice would do well too. I forgot to get some of that. Oh, got it. I missed a couple things today. Something else I missed. It's really. Oh, yeah. Okay. I got a shopping list in my head. Yeah. Just to make sure you drink that kale pomegranate juice, and then you can have something good, too. Psychology works there. I just hope I don't wake up tomorrow looking green or like Popeye. I don't know. What's that stuff supposed to do? It's like drinking chlorophyll or something. But yeah, went for 2 eggs. Just, wow. Double egg, that's getting pretty intense there. But I need the body to recover and try to build up strength. If you're really working hard, you know, you got to have to do something to build up some strength. How about just straight kale and tart cherry juice, and then pecan pie, and just say that's it. That's a good meal right there. Polar opposites. Man, Greek yogurt's always good. Just keep throwing the Greek yogurt in there, and it makes it all good. If you want to cheat with something, cheat just with Greek yogurt. Absolutely, why not? So keep that good habits rolling as I do. I know there's a everyone's very busy now. Christmas time, it's getting really close, isn't it? But right here we just keep on trucking here. I mean, this is we need escape velocity. I mean, we cannot just keep hitting idiotic shots. I mean, when we do, praise a great idiotic shot, but then say, okay, let me hit a good amateur shot here, and then let me hit a good pro shot. So let's get the pra keep the practicing going intensely, then let's start experiencing the light. Absolutely, start experiencing the light. True light. Keep it in mind, there's no such thing as corrupted light. All light is true light. All light is true 100% pure light. All of it. Then light is all there is. There's no corruption. Only the realization that there's never any corruption, only that freeze. As long as we keep thinking that one magnetic light is true light, as far as this is the way real light really is, then, and not a pretense, then we're deluded. And as long as we keep saying, well, I gotta purify the light, this is a contamination of the light, we're still completely deluded. Those ways don't work. Light, 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 true light from true light. They even have that in, I think, the Mass. True light from true light, God from God, true light from true light, something like that. Well, yeah. So there's bits and pieces there, right? But then it's all twisted around, and the body and the blood and the vicarious atonement to appease God's wrath and take our sins and pay the price for punishment for our sins. Oh my God, okay. There's no escape velocity in there. Maybe that's why that little girl was showing escape velocity. She kept looking up. Maybe she's saying, look up to the light, look up to the light. Sometimes she'd bend her head completely backwards, so her head was like upside down if she was looking at you that way. With eyes looking at you like that, just like, wow. But particularly looking up like that. Maybe she's saying, look up to the light, escape velocity, true light, true light. I mean, I got a better spiritual experience from that little girl than the priest and the congregation, I'm telling you. That was profound. That was profound. Her actions were profound, I'm telling you. Reminded me of Anandamayi, absolutely. In that, just the way that she was so profound that something about it just said, wow. Without saying a word, the little girl never spoke at all. But her expressions on her face and her antics were so unusual. And she never looked at you like a normal person would look at another person like, a threat. She didn't look at you like you're a threat. And so it's like, huh. She kind of looked past you. She might look a little bit, but, you know, just different, 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 different. But she wasn't startled. You know, she'd kind of looking at you like that. Ordinary person, you look back at them and kind of, oh, recognize, but she wouldn't. She just keep kind of looking like that. And then when she stopped looking, it wasn't like she was breaking off contact with someone human that she was looking at. It wasn't like that at all. It was just like a smooth continuum where there's no personal human sort of connection or relationship that we're making necessarily, that's broken off, that starts and stops and everything. It was just a smooth continuum entirely. I'll take that any day. I'll take that over human interaction for sure. Very similar to Sri Sri Anandamayi. It reminded me of that, very much so. There was just nothing but a perpetually smooth continuum. So there's never any entering into relationship and then leaving it. Nothing like that. It was always, there was always this presence there. No matter what, looking here or looking there, there's whatever the kindness, the compassion, it was always full on. Never started, never stopped. Never started, never stopped. This is the true light. Of course, it never starts and never stops. Sri Sri Anandamayi was the true light, was the real light, was the true light. Absolutely was. She said again that she didn't see us as bodies at all, saw us as beautiful golden eggs of light. Just absolutely splendid, beautifully splendid. And didn't see things the way we see it at all. So how did it as true light? And so it was a smooth continuum. True light's just a smooth continuum. There isn't say, oh, I see so Joe or Susie or whatever, you know, what do their bodies look like? What are their expressions like? And I need to talk with them and convey, okay, now we finished with our this. It wasn't like that. It was just always this smooth presence. Whatever expression there was, it never gave the sense of some abruptness or to it or something. Of course, we would. Most people would say, "Well, that's something wrong with a child, retarded." No, 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 no. That's how the true light acts, actually. And the child was not really acting in a way that indicated mental dysfunction. Because you notice if that's the case, there's something like, you know, not something not working properly. Not really. They didn't get that feeling like, of sort of like, oh gosh, that's too bad, you know. No. It's very, very great experience. And just the way she look at you, it's different expression. Like, she's not really looking at a human. The way she's viewing you is not the way humans view humans. Sort of like this. And just, and not a hyperactive child either. It wasn't that hyperactive disorder or compulsive disorder, any of those things, no. Maybe that's a precursor, you know, foreshadowing of something. I'll tell you, again, I'll take that. I will take that. It's very different. You didn't feel like saying anything to her. You just sort of enjoyed the antics and just says, wow. She's like, wow, that's never seen that expression before. Or combinations of expressions. The expressions that she had didn't seem to be relating to normal human expressiveness of the combinations that we have, you know, that we normal things like, oh, okay, hi, how are you? No, but I like the combinations, expressions, the different ones. It's just unexpected, like you didn't expect that. And it wasn't like, again, bad or off the mark or fear. You didn't see any fearful expressions on her face, actually. No, it wasn't fear at all. It was friendly, interest and friendliness. It's like, but what was she looking at? I don't know. So, this is quite felicity, you know, serendipitous to sort of realize that how does the light act, the true light act in this world? It could be this just a smoothness that is not really, we're not used to the type of expressions it strings together. I found it to be very easy to just to be there. And well, it was okay. I wasn't paying attention to the service. Not much attention. A little bit, but not much. And it wasn't disruptive in the normal way. A disruptive child, you can tell, was not being disruptive either. So it was really. And we talked about it afterwards. Everyone, it felt the same way. It's like, yeah, this is really a precious child, no question about it. Very endearing. And also very different. Interesting, we're talking about Christmas, the Christ child. What's the Christ child? The true light in this world. And the true light acts quite different. Quite different. But in a better way. We say, ah, this is very endearing. And when we try to force language on them and learning all that stuff, you know, then it becomes frustrating for us. No. Just, we don't need to communicate with language. We don't have to learn anything. We just, it's so endearing that in itself is profound. We start thinking, hey, wait a minute. Is this different? Is this wrong? Or is it better? Start thinking, maybe this is even better. I say, well, it's not so functional here. Yeah, but maybe it's giving plausible inference for the true light that something better, plausible inference. That's what I got out of that little girl, was plausible inference. Maybe there's something better that she was expressing here. But for us to say, well, it's not so functional, electromagnetic realm of learning and all this stuff. Well, yeah, maybe not. But maybe if we saw it in a different way, we'd say, hey, this is like super functional, actually. Because the super function is to choose the lighted realm. Change the purpose of the dream. Instead of electromagnetic dream of the lighted realm, of plausible inference that reality, light hasn't changed. That maybe that's super functionality. Not maybe, it is. It is super functionality. So I wasn't the only one who picked up on this. No, absolutely not. That's interesting. Same impression to others. Not to the level of sophistication we're talking about here, but the overall impression was a very positive impression, even though no words were spoken and no learning took place. And, you know, but we weren't saying, oh, poor child is going to go through life as, you know, special needs child. No, we said, wow, yeah, that wasn't the feeling. There wasn't pity. There wasn't a pity feeling at all. So, you know, maybe we had a miracle there. Never seen these people before. And the parents were, if that's what they were, weren't really worried about her. I guess they were used to it. I guess they trusted and realized that she's not a problem. She doesn't create problems. So they just didn't really much pay attention to her, and she's, yeah, it's really, really interesting here. And onto my mom, always insisted she was just a little child, just a little child. And that's it. Never changed from that. Meaning, did not learn the ways of this world of how to relate as a quote unquote adult, keeping this smooth continuum of presence all the time. And she likened it to being like a little child. Well, she said, never grew up. Meaning, never learned the lessons of electromagnetism. You know, never changed. Never grew up in that way. Wow. Very, 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 very wowish day, to say the least. So I hope you're having a very wowish day, and I hope this video has helped you have a more of a wowish day. That's the whole point of it. Got to get the wow of every day. Has to be very wowish. We should say to people, have a wowish day. So have a nice day. Have a very wowish day. Maybe I'll start doing this. Hey, have a very wowish day. You know, it's got to be big. So it's so big that it's like, wow. Have a wowish day. Okay, it's cold enough out here. I don't have anything on my head. I don't want to freeze out here. I'm going to go get some pecan pie, y'all. And we'll see y'all later. Okay, have a very wowish day. very wowish day. Have a very wowish day. It's still recording. It hasn't stopped. Oh, okay. Well, it says it stopped, so I'm going to stop it.